This is Eye on Africa, France 24's program focused on the continent. I'm Charlie James, in for Georgia Calvin Smith, and these are the headlines. French troops leaving a key base in Timbuktu, handing it over to the Malian military. We explain how this marks a turning point in the wider Sahel mission. Kenya's High Court suspends a mandatory COVID vaccination order, saying it violates the Constitution. The unvaccinated would have had limited access to public spaces and government services. And Congolese rumba wins UNESCO World Heritage status. France 24 shows you how the music and dance tradition jumped from Africa to Cuba to the world. Thanks so much for spending part of your evening with us here. After 9 years, French troops are leaving the Malian city of Timbuktu on Tuesday night. First deployed by former President François Hollande, the soldiers were tasked with fighting rebels affiliated with Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State group. They are departing as part of a wider troop drawdown in the Sahel, as Yenke Ayotade explains.
The final touches before they pull out. These French troops, like thousands of others, have been stationed in the city of Timbuktu for the past 8 years. This under the name of Barkhane, a counter-terrorism operation designed to hunt down jihadists. It was here that then-President François Hollande formally declared the start of France's military intervention. The launch came after French forces and Malian troops liberated Timbuktu, putting an end to 8 months of Islamist occupation there. It was hailed as a big win for the former French president.
What do you want to say to President Hollande?
He's a hero, he's a national hero. Thank you so much.
8 years later, the Malian population are not as jovial. The country is still plagued by jihadist attacks, and relations with Paris have soured. The terrorist threat has spread into neighboring Burkina Faso and Niger, and France's counter-terrorism fight has spread with it. But in June of this year, President Emmanuel Macron announced a major drawdown of French troops. Soldiers have already left bases in Kidal on the 12th of October and Tessalit last month. Both are located in the north of Mali. French authorities say there will only be 3,000 troops left in the country by the summer of 2022, this out of the 5,000 soldiers that were originally deployed. President Emmanuel Macron is banking on a separate European defence force, known as Takuba, to beef up security in the region. But they will be competing with Russia, who is also vying for more influence in the Sahel. Mali's military junta was in discussions about deploying the Wagner group in the country, a move that Paris has condemned.
Kenya's High Court has suspended a government order that would have prevented unvaccinated citizens from accessing in-person government services. The country announced the measure last month, saying that from December 21st, only those vaccinated could go to schools, immigration offices, and more. Caroline Kimeo, our correspondent in Nairobi, has more on the case against the order.
The government issued the order in November to increase vaccine uptake in the country. Only around 12% of the country's population has been fully vaccinated, and the government is looking to ensure that 10 million Kenyans are vaccinated by the end of 2021. Now, businessman Enoch Aura, who filed the case, says that the government directive constitutes a gross violation of human rights and is discrimination on the basis of health. Now, there's also the added factor that the country does not have enough vaccines to ensure that the entire adult population is vaccinated by the December 21st deadline. On the country's Independence Day celebrations on Sunday, Health Cabinet Secretary Mutahi Kagwe encouraged Kenyans to go out and get vaccinated. He clarified that the vaccine is voluntary and that the government mandate only applied to those seeking in-person government services. Now, despite enormous pushback, the initiative has shown promising results so far, with close to 1 million people getting vaccinated over the last month. The court's decision to suspend the government directive will stay in force until the case is heard and determined in January 4th, 2022.
That was France 24's Caroline Camillo. Opponents of Tunisian President Kais Saied are slamming his decision to extend the months-long suspension of parliament. They're accusing him of continuing his power grab at the expense of democracy. On Monday, Saied announced parliament will remain suspended until elections are held in December of next year. He also said a constitutional referendum will be held in July. The announcements have divided Tunisian society.
يربح في الوقت وسامبلومون يحب يطبق الحاجات اللي في مخه يعني
الانتخاب احنا من بكري كنا نطالبوا به مش هو قراره على خاطر هو مطلب شعبي قبل كل شيء ما كانش هو خذ القرارات وحده على خاطر الشعب هو خرج نهار 25 جويلية طلب بإسقاط المنظومة كاملة حل البرلمان ثم كانت المطالب انه إعادة القانون الانتخابي فهمت
Islamist violence across Burkina Faso, Mali, and Niger has forced more than 2 million people from their homes. And now the region is facing food shortages as well due to erratic rainfall. Already 5.5 million people are struggling with food insecurity, a number that is expected to rise substantially. Laurent Berstecker takes a closer look.
9 months old, Sakinatu Amadou has been in the care of her grandmother since her own mother passed away. Today, she's receiving her first medical checkup.
Her mother died. I took the child to the medical center, and they found that she was ill.
Amadou was diagnosed with stunted growth caused by malnutrition, a disorder which now affects 1 in 4 children in Burkina Faso. The country, which derives 80% of its resources from agriculture, has seen a sprawling jihadist insurgency force nearly 1.5 million people to flee their homes since 2015, leaving their crops and animals behind. This caused widespread food shortages, which have been compounded by drought and the COVID-19 pandemic. With famine looming, school headmaster Abdoulaye Bokoum tries to make sure there's always something to eat for his pupils.
This year, we hosted 144 displaced children from an area with a very high security risk. They were all traumatized. When they see that at lunchtime there's a meal they can all share together, it facilitates integration. When you see these children eating with their peers, there's nothing like it. You can see their relief.
Bokoum also set up a school garden where children can grow their own vegetables and take them home, an attempt to introduce a semblance of security and stability in a region where some 5.5 million people are currently struggling with food shortages.
Finally, one of Africa's most influential genres of music and dance now has UNESCO-protected status. Congolese rumba was recognized Tuesday after a joint campaign by the Democratic Republic of Congo and neighboring Republic of the Congo. UNESCO's Director General explained to France 24 why rumba was chosen.
This is what is absolutely magical about rumba and about music in general. It's you have all the movements of the world, the movements here of history, of long history, of sometimes very painful history, but you have also a very alive music and a culture that goes with this music. The clothing, the partying, the dancing, it's very much alive today, and I was happy to see it.
Rumba has its roots in Central Africa, was born in its modern form in Cuba, and today has millions of fans around the world. Our correspondents in Kinshasa went to meet those who keep traditional Congolese rumba alive in the capital.
At 77, Guvane Vangu has lost none of his skills. Back in the 60s, he would play this song alongside Tabule Rochereau, one of the legends of Congolese rumba. Guvane was then the lead guitarist in the African Fiesta Orchestra.
This is me performing with my friends. That's me right there.
In those years, the entire Congolese capital was vibrating to the rhythm of rumba.
Back then, there were concerts almost every day, from Monday to Monday, and people would come in large numbers because there weren't many bands at the time. And this was the only form of entertainment. Those who had a band were the ones attracting the public.
Derived from Kumba, a naval dance from Central Africa, rumba was born on Cuban soil and returned to Congo in the 1940s. In 1960, it became the anthem of independence and went on to inspire hundreds of artists over the decades. In this cultural center in Kinshasa, musicians come to learn about its secrets.
This is what traditional rumba sounds like. Rumba has a history. So you can't make real rumba if you don't take inspiration from the old rumba. As a young musician, if you understand what rumba is about, then you can also create other genres.
A bridge between past and present. For this historian, rumba has a unique place in Congolese history.
Rumba is, so to speak, a thread that connects us all. It binds us as a nation. Wherever you go in the Democratic Republic of Congo, rumba is always a common theme.
A common theme and now a universal treasure. Rumba will continue to make people dance on both banks of the Congo River for a long time to come.
Do stay with us here on France 24. More news and information up next.